Thank you for inviting me, and welcome to everyone who's come to attend. I hope you find what I have to say interesting. And also, I've never spoken with a translator before, so it will disrupt my speaking style, but I hope you've managed to understand. You would therefore expect that AFG, Alternative for Germany, if in fact BDS was anti-Semitic, that it would have voted against the resolution, since AFD has many neo-Nazis, it's a racist party, it has anti-Semitism, it's Semites in it. But AFD, Alternative for Germany, not only is a strongest supporter for the idea that BDS is illegal, it is anti-Semitic, but it wanted to make BDS illegal, a crime. The reality, of course, today, indeed it always has been, is that Zionism has no problem with anti-Semitism. Who are the best friends of Israel today? Number one is Viktor Orban, the Prime Minister of Hungary. He described Admiral Horthy, you know, the Nazi, pro-Nazi leader of wartime Hungary, a dedicated anti-Semite, who presided over the deportation of 500,000 Jews to Auschwitz as, quote, an exceptional statesman. But Viktor Orban, who waged an election campaign earlier this year, an anti-Semitic campaign against George Soros, is the best friend of Benjamin Netanyahu. And who else is a good friend of Israel? The president of Philippines, Duterte, who described his campaign against people who are drug users as another Holocaust. He is an admirer of Hitler. And of course, we should not forget Donald Trump, who tells American Jews that Israel is your country. Or, for example, Richard Spencer. You may not have heard of him, but he is the founder of the alt-right in the United States, who describes himself as a white Zionist. The reality is, as I said, that Zionism has never opposed anti-Semitism because it has always accepted anti-Semitism. Zionism was a political reaction amongst Jews to anti-Semitism. In fact, the first Zionists were not Jewish, they were Christian fundamentalists. Napoleon III, Ernest Laharan, Lord Shaftesbury, Lord Palmerston, many British imperialists, Christians wanted the Jews to establish a Jewish state. And up till the Second World War, the majority of Jews opposed Zionism. For example, the country with the most Jews in Europe was Poland. It had 3.3 million. In 1938, there were the last free elections in Poland, which the Bund won in Warsaw, for example. Out of 20 Jewish council seats, the Bund, which was an anti-Zionist Jewish socialist group, won 17. The Zionists won one. Zionism was a reaction, primarily, what started as the reaction to the pogroms in Tsarist Russia from 1881 onwards. But it was a unique reaction, because it was a reaction which accepted that the anti-Semites were right, that the Jews did not belong where they lived. The problem was that the Jews did not have their own state. And the result is that the Zionists and the anti-Semites often agreed with each other. The founder of Zionism, political Zionism, was a man called Theodor Herzl. I don't know whether any of you have heard of him.
Yes.
He was a Viennese journalist who reported in Paris. I could spend an hour just on Herzl. Herzl wrote a pamphlet
It was called the Judenstadt. It was published in 1894-1895. Does anyone remember or know what happened in 1894?
Dreyfus.
Yes, Dreyfus.
Yes,
Dreyfus. The Jewish captain who was accused of writing a letter to you Germans, promising to betray France and give you all his secrets. And in the Judenstadt, the Jewish state, there is not one reference to Dreyfus in the entire pamphlet. Indeed, there is only passing references to Dreyfus in Herzl's four volumes diaries. They are 1600 pages, and I've read every page. Just passing references, nothing substantive about Dreyfus. And in fact, in his diaries, Herzl describes what happened, how he felt in Paris, and he said, and I quote, "In Paris, I achieved a freer attitude to antisemitism, which I now began to understand historically and to pardon, to forgive. Above all, I recognize the emptiness and futility of trying to combat antisemitism." And another early Zionist, even earlier than Herzl, was Leo Pinsker, and he described the Zionist attitude to antisemitism, which he called Judeophobia, the fear of Jews. He said, "Judeophobia is a mental disease, and as a mental disease, it is hereditary." Because that was in those days, they believed it was hereditary, everything. "And having been inherited for 2,000 years, it is incurable." He wrote this in a book, a pamphlet, called Auto-Emancipation, of how we emancipate ourselves. Now, if antisemitism is a disease and it is incurable, there's no point in trying to cure it, is there? If you have a patient who has an incurable disease, you make them as comfortable as possible, but you don't try remedies on them which will cause them pain and discomfort. There's no point. Why? This was the attitude of Zionism towards antisemitism. Antisemitism was a disease. It was incurable. It had been inherited for 2,000 years. There was no point in fighting it. In Herzl's words, it was an emptiness and futility of trying to. You could not fight antisemitism. And so Zionism really started from that point, that you could not fight it. And if you could not fight it, then you had an interest in common with antisemitism, because the anti-Semites wanted the Jews to leave Europe. And the Zionists also wanted the Jews to leave Europe. If you do not believe me, then I suggest that you get on Amazon a copy of The Jewish State by Herzl. He says, for example, "I have already mentioned that honest anti-Semites, presumably some are dishonest, while preserving their independence, will combine with our officials in controlling the transfer of our estates. So there was this coincidence of interest. For example, Herzl travelled throughout Europe meeting leaders and royal persons and so on. For example, he met the Grand Duke of Baden. It was then an independent state within the overall Germany. And he said to the Grand Duke, will you support Zionism? And the Grand Duke said, yes, of course I support Zionism. But my one problem is that if I support you openly, people will accuse me of anti-Semitism. Zionism was seen as a form of Jewish anti-Semitism. For example, when Hitler came to power in Germany, only 3% of the German Jews were Zionists. The vast majority were not Zionists. The whole ideology of the Zionists was that the Jews were a separate nation. They were not part of the German nation, something that the Nuremberg Laws in 1935 legislated for. Jews were a separate nation. They were not Germans. They were Jewish. Mm-hmm. In the words of Lucian Wolf, who was a leader of the British Jewish Board of Deputies, said, "I have spent most of my life combating these very doctrines when presented to me in the form of antisemitism, and I can only regard them as more dangerous when they come to me in the guise of Zionism. They are the capitulation to our enemies." Mm. So when today people accuse you of antisemitism for supporting the Palestinians or opposing Zionism, you have to remember that historically the main opposition to Zionism came from Jews. You have heard, have you, of the Balfour Declaration?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Well, it was approved by the cabinet, the war cabinet of Lloyd George, who was the British Prime Minister. The only member of the Lloyd George cabinet to oppose it was its only Jewish member, Sir Edwin Montagu, who accused the rest of them of anti-Semitism. I'll quote to you, it's from an article in the London Jewish Chronicle by A.B. Yehoshua, who is an Israeli poet and novelist. And I'll give it to you to quote so you need to remember it. He said, "Anti-Zionism is not the product of the non-Jews. On the contrary, the Gentiles as non-Jews, have always encouraged the Zionism, hoping it would help to rid them of the Jews in their midst. Even today, in a perverse way, a real anti-Semite must also be a Zionist. You will also be told about the Jewish return to Palestine," which was a Christian, not a Jewish idea, incidentally. "Between 1850, the middle of the 19th century, and 1914, 2.5 million Jews left Russia because of the pogroms, the poverty, and so on. Barely more than 1% went to Palestine. There was nothing stopping them. There were no immigration controls. There were no borders. It was part of the Ottoman Empire. But most Jews didn't even think about going to Palestine." I want to say a little about the Zionist relationship and attitude to the Nazis. It is a controversial topic. What was the Zionist attitude to the Nazis? The Zionist Congress was held in Prague in September 1933. There was no condemnation of the Nazis at that conference. On the contrary, the Zionist leaders, and I differentiate between the leaders and ordinary Zionists, Earl Katzenelson, who was the deputy to David Ben-Gurion, a founder of Mapai, the editor of Davar, the paper of Histadrut, said about the rise of Hitler, "It was an opportunity to build and flourish like none we have ever had or ever will have." There is a new book by Tom Segev, who is a very established Israeli historian. He has produced a biography of David Ben-Gurion. Have you heard of David Ben-Gurion?
Yes.
He was the first Prime Minister of Israel. He was chairman of the Jewish Agency. He was a key figure in the establishment of the Jewish state. He said the Nazis' victory would become a fertile force for Zionism. I mean, you've heard of, say, Ben-Gurion. His official biographer was a man called Shabtai Tevet. And I have the chapter from his biography which deals with the Holocaust. The chapter is called "Disaster Means Strength," the disaster being the Holocaust. Shabtai Tevet was not just a biographer, he was the official biographer chosen by Ben-Gurion's own family. I'll give you a few quotes from this chapter, but you can get it from the library, I imagine, and borrow it and read it for yourself. So nothing I say is made up. And Ben-Gurion outlined exactly what the role of Zionism was during the Holocaust. He said, "If Zionism along the way saves a few thousand tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of individuals, so much the better. But in the event of a conflict of interest between saving individual Jews and the good of the Zionist enterprise, we shall say the Zionist enterprise comes first. And Tevet remarks, if there was a line in Ben-Gurion's mind between the beneficial disaster, the beneficial means a good thing, and an all-destroying catastrophe, it must have been a very fine line. In 1933, on the 21st of June, the Zionist Federation of Germany wrote a letter to Hitler. They never got a reply. The letter can be found in the Holocaust reader of Lucy Davidovits, who is a well-known Zionist historian. She's died now, but it's called the Holocaust Reader, and anyone who is interested can look it up. And he wrote, on the foundation of the new state, which has established the principle of race, fruitful activity for the fatherland is possible. Our acknowledgement of Jewish nationality provides for a clear and sincere relationship to the German people and its national and racial realities. Off with BDS. Now, you may know that when Hitler came to power, Jews internationally and the labour movement, the socialist movement, launched a boycott of Nazi Germany. And you won't be surprised to know that the Zionists did not support it. In August 1933, the Zionists reached an agreement with Hitler called Havarah, the Trade Transfer Agreement, whereby German goods were supplied to Palestine out of the money of German Jews, and that broke the boycott. The boycott of Nazi Germany was causing extremely severe problems for the Hitler economy. People talked about Hitler not lasting more than a year. The exports had gone right down to every country, the United States, Britain, and so on. So the Nazis were extremely worried. For the Zionists, it was extremely important. 60% of capital investment in Jewish Palestine between 1933 and 1939 came from Nazi Germany. Literally, Hitler built the Jewish state.
Germany is still building.
Well, yes, it is. I mean, in a sense, the German ruling class, the German state, has transferred its guilt about the Holocaust onto the shoulders of the Palestinians. And for the Zionists, the Palestinians are the new Nazis. I mean, that is true.
Yeah.
And the relationship between the Zionist Federation in Germany and the Nazis was a close one. Of course, the Nazis had power and the Zionists did not have power. So no one should equate the Zionists with the Nazis. The Zionists collaborated with people who were much stronger than them. You have all heard of Reinhard Heydrich, I assume. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was deputy to Himmler. Mm-hmm. He said in January 1935, a directive was issued to the Gestapo, which he commanded. The activity of the Zionist-oriented youth organizations that are engaged in the occupational restructuring of Jews for agriculture and manual trades lies in the interest of the National Socialist state leadership. As I say, I started with BDS, boycott, divestment and sanctions. The boycott has a very long, can you hear me, sorry, mm-hmm. Yeah, history. It started, does anyone know where the term boycott started?
Ireland.
Precisely, yes. Captain Boycott, he was an English land agent and the Irish peasants boycotted him because he was driving them off of the land. Probably the first boycott was the boycott of slave-grown sugar in the West Indies. I've told you, of course, about the Jewish boycott of Nazi Germany, but the other famous boycott was the boycott of apartheid South Africa. The idea that boycott of Israel is anti-Semitic is a nonsense. Boycott is the weapon of the oppressed, the powerless. It always has been and always will be. Israel today is an ethno-nationalist state. In many, just as Nazi Germany, Poland, Hungary, Croatia, Romania, before in the 1930s and 1940s, was also an ethno-nationalist state. As Benjamin Netanyahu said to the actress Rotem Sala, a famous Israeli actress, who said, well, even the Arabs are human beings, they are citizens. He said, Israel is not a state of its own citizens, it's a state of its Jewish citizens. And that is what makes it an apartheid state. So, for example, there are 40,000 black African refugees from Eritrea and the Sudan in Israel. Everyone agrees that Eritrea is an extremely repressive state. But Israel wants to deport all 40,000. Why? Because they're not Jewish. And even worse, they're not white. And it's not just Netanyahu. I mean, I have a clip from Haaretz, a liberal Israeli paper. The Israeli Labour Party supports that policy. There is a consensus amongst the Zionist leaders in Israel that they do not belong because they dilute Jewish identity in the Israeli state. And one of the favourite set slogans of Israeli right-wing demonstrators is, and I again show you how, it's death to the Arabs. No one has been arrested for that. In Poland and Germany before the war, the slogan was death to the Jews. I ask you, is it anti-Semitic to compare Nazi Germany to Israel? In 2014, you remember the war, or the attack on Gaza, when 550 children were killed, 2,000 people were killed, thousands were injured and made homeless. In Tel Aviv, Israelis marched, here it is, again, it's in the Huff Post. There's no school in Gaza. Why? Because there are no kids left. This was a demonstration celebrating the death of children in Gaza. And that is a reality of Israel today. Israel is by far and away the most racist state in the world. In a recent opinion poll for Pew Research Center, 48% of Israelis want, or Jewish Israelis, want the deportation of Arabs living in Israel, never mind the West Bank, as opposed to 46% against. 60% don't want Arabs, would not allow an Arab in their home. And 79% don't want to live next to Arabs. That, my friends, and I'll finish here, is what a Jewish state means. Thank you.